but is now empty. And this is the reason why the Catholic Church, because without the house of God, you probably would have ended up in the Reformation. They produced for Felix the Sixth, amongst others, who went around raping his sisters and raping his sisters-in-law. Right? So that is history. What's the difference? The people who produced the Borgias and Louis the 14th and Christopher Columbus and today see as what? Civilized. And we Africans somehow who produced the Vekulas and Shaka Zulus and Mansa Musa are supposedly uncivilized. What was the difference? The colonial system did what? Stunted our evolution of systems that could have resolved our development crisis. And so, while these people were able to sort out their problems over time through their political mechanisms, our processes were stunted. And if you look at the history of, say, Burundi or Rwanda, both of which, in fact, were pre-colonial monarchies. And so, Burundi's monarchy was toppled in 1966 to 65, but effectively 66 March. And Rwanda's monarchy was toppled with the when the Mwami was deposed in 1959, the Hutu Revolution. But if you look at their history, what is evident there? That if we had continued our evolution, we would have, well, they have made much more progress. And so we need a balanced view of our history, and that's part of the challenge of discussing conflict in Africa. And what's my final proposition? It's a theory that every African conflict is transboundary and transliteration. There is no self-contained African outcome. Now, to illustrate that, we need to operationalize our conflict. I'm not going into definitions here. But, you know, in strategic studies, they will tell you armed conflict is one in which there have been 1,000 field killings in a year, which then asks you the question, who got to the counting of the dead bodies? It's rather dangerous, isn't it? You go around counting how many dead bodies have been in any field of conflict in 1 year, and then when you get to 1,000, you say, oh, there's a war. I think it is 999. No, it's not a war. And the historians just resort, humanities say, well, if there's a shooting affair in which you've got more than two parties, or two parties or more, then it's a conflict. I used to be a lawyer, I failed at that, so you'll forgive me. But you learn a few habits from that, part of which is sometimes it just defaults to bad habits. But the lawyers distinguish between international armed conflict and non-international armed conflict. The international armed conflict will be war that happens between two or more countries. And we've got some classics in Africa. In 1978, Idi Amin invaded the Kagera in Tanzania, claiming the Kagera Salient. The Kagera Salient is a territory in the south of Tanzania, barely 700 square miles there. But Amin and Nyerere never got along because Nyerere was very close, and Nyerere, for those who, I'm sure everybody knows that Nyerere was the founder of Tanzania. And he was the president of Tanzania at the time. Tanzania hosted the Secretariat of East African Community in Arusha. And Amin overthrew Milton Obote, who was Nyerere's very good friend, in 1971. And so, Nyerere locked up the Secretariat of East African Community and refused to ever meet with Amin. So in 72, Amin sent over some exiles to go and try and harass Tanzania. They were repulsed. The friends again in 75, they were repulsed. By 1978, he moved in Femi Kagera, and Nyerere said that was enough. So what did he do? He repeated a ban of running Tanzanian Ugandan exile. One of them was a former student of the University of Dar es Salaam called Yoweri Museveni. And he recruited them, organized them, and they went and did what? They toppled Amin in 1979, April. That's the story of what that was an international outcome. You also had the war between Libya and Chad over the Al-Sus, which is to the north of Chad and borders with Libya. And that took place over 9-10 years, between 1978 and 1987. fighting child, but also had each other fighting one another. When you were there against this attacker, and they were recruiting different factions. And so Libya was fighting Chad, and Libya was recruiting Chadian rebels to fight against one another. And you also had France fighting against Libya and fighting in favor of its satrap in Chad. It was a complex situation. But we've had the most recent, of course, of our international armed conflict in Africa was Eritrea and Ethiopia. Senseless war. But you know what? Until 1897, Ethiopia had two ports. One was the port of Djibouti, the other was the port of Assam. Now, in 1897, Frederick II decided to modernize Ethiopia. So what did he do? He sold off the port of Djibouti to France to enable him on the modernization of Ethiopia. And Djibouti sped up, eventually became a different country. Ethiopia lost that port. It was left Assam. In 1991, Eritrea went up to the port of Assam and Ethiopia became a landlocked country. The war in 1998 was fought over access to water and access to the port of Assam on the south. And that is a war, and became an international outcome over resource, access to maritime borders, territory. And in the end, the conflict only ended effectively last year when the new prime minister of Ethiopia, Abiy Ahmed, went to see Zaire in Asmara, where they signed the armistice. Now, but some conflicts are not easy to define as international and not international. And I'll give you an example. The Second Congo War. The Second Congo War was fought by 9 African countries. Some people describe it as the Third World War. You had Rwanda, Burundi, and Uganda recruiting, fighting, having recruited Kabila, because Museveni basically reprised the playbook of Nyerere in 1978-1997 when they decided to overthrow Mobutu. And I'll get to that story in a moment. But there were Uganda, Rwanda, and Burundi on the one hand, then you had Sudan, you had Chad, you had Zimbabwe, you had Namibia, and you had Angola, and you had your 9 countries fighting that war. The Lusaka Peace Agreement was reached in Lusaka, these 6 countries, one of whom had declared war against one another, to try and settle the DRC war in 1999. And that conflict, every one of those countries, one, was wrestling DRC resources, but second, was wrestling armed factions in the DRC to use against one another. It was the most complex conflict on our continent, and what that just demonstrates to you how permeable our borders are and how permeable our conflicts are in terms of generations and time. But you cannot understand that story without having to go back. Although I would like to start with pre-colonial or colonial times, I want to actually go just take the story tonight.